Donc bonjour à tous. On a peu de monde pour l'instant, mais on espère que ça va arriver. L'objet de cette conférence aujourd'hui, alors juste pour me présenter, moi je m'appelle Guillaume de la Boulèche, l'association Énergie 2050. On a un stand un peu plus loin là-bas. Et on travaille, on a une vision assez systémique du développement durable. Donc on travaille sur le développement durable, la lutte contre le changement climatique. Avec un certain nombre d'activités, des formations, mais on a des projets, dont certains que je vais présenter aujourd'hui. L'objet de la conférence aujourd'hui, ça va être de voir quelles opportunités existent dans le domaine du bâtiment, dans cette lutte contre le changement climatique. Parce qu'au-delà des négociations qui se déroulent en ce moment au Bourget à Paris, l'important aujourd'hui, c'est de mettre en œuvre, de mettre en avant les opportunités d'action qui existent dans différents domaines, et particulièrement le bâtiment. Alors pourquoi particulièrement le bâtiment? Parce qu'aujourd'hui vous avez un monde qui est de plus en plus urbain. Vous avez les villes qui ne représentent que 4% de la surface terrestre mais consomment 60 à 80% de l'énergie, 75% des ressources naturelles qui sont produites, qui sont extraites et qui sont responsables de 75% des émissions globales de CO2. Vous avez un taux d'urbanisation qui pourrait dépasser 75% d'ici 2050. Et si on décline ça au niveau du bâtiment, en fait, le bâtiment, il est au cœur des enjeux du climat, autant pour ce qui est de ce qu'on appelle l'atténuation, la réduction des émissions de gaz à effet de serre, que pour l'adaptation, c'est-à-dire vous avez un certain nombre de choses que vous pouvez mettre en œuvre dans le bâtiment pour vous adapter aux effets du changement climatique. On peut le dire ici, mais également au niveau des pays africains, puisque cette conférence concerne aussi les pays du Sud, on pourrait revenir un petit peu. Les bâtiments, c'est aujourd'hui, selon le GIEC, donc le groupe intergouvernemental sur la notion du climat, selon le GIEC, c'est 32% de la demande énergétique mondiale. Donc vous voyez un peu les opportunités que ça peut comprendre. C'est responsable de la consommation de 3 milliards de tonnes de matières premières par an, 12% de la consommation d'eau, 40% des déchets solides générés dans les pays développés, et surtout en 2010, le bâtiment était responsable pour un cinquième du total des émissions de CO2. Et avec le processus d'urbanisation, avec la multiplication du nombre de bâtiments, notamment dans un certain nombre de pays, on va avoir une multiplication par 5 du nombre de bâtiments, notamment en Afrique. Les émissions du secteur du bâtiment, si on continue sur notre trajectoire actuelle, devraient être 4 à 5 fois supérieures à ce qu'elles sont aujourd'hui. Donc autant vous dire qu'en termes de lutte contre le changement climatique, si on ne met pas en place les bonnes politiques dans le domaine du bâtiment et plus généralement dans le domaine de l'environnement construit, on ne pourra pas arriver aux objectifs qui ont été fixés, l'objectif des 2 degrés, l'objectif d'un 1,5 degré, ça dépend des pays, mais très clairement le bâtiment doit être au centre de tout ce qu'on va faire en termes de politique climatique. Et ce qui est intéressant de voir, et c'est l'objet de la conférence aujourd'hui, je vais un petit peu vite pour laisser la place à plein de nos intervenants, c'est qu'en fait on a une multitude d'opportunités qui existent, on a beaucoup de choses qui sont faites et qui peuvent être dupliquées pour être systématisées au niveau des sociétés et apporter tous les bénéfices qu'on attend d'une politique dans le domaine du bâtiment. Pour ça en fait on va avoir plusieurs présentations, donc d'action, on a, je ne sais pas si du coup tu as pu accéder. Bon, en tout cas, on aura une présentation d'un des projets dans lequel on a appliqué, qui est Nézé, qui est hôtel presque zéro énergie, donc on vous expliquera ça. Une autre présentation du secteur privé de l'entreprise VSMA. Et moi, je vais vous présenter un peu nos actions dans le domaine du bâtiment qu'on fait à Énergie 2050. Pour ne pas faire du plaidoyer, nous on fait de l'action, c'est pour montrer qu'il y a des possibilités. Donc voilà, ça c'est nous. Je vous ai dit, on travaille pour la grande transition, donc avec une approche assez systémique du développement, où on intervient dans beaucoup de domaines parce qu'on croit que la solution ne peut pas être juste énergétique, elle ne peut pas être juste économique, ni juste sociale, ni juste environnementale. Il faut vraiment avoir une vision globale avec une approche dans différents domaines d'activité. Sur l'environnement construit, je vais commencer déjà, vous voyez, là on a mis notre joli kakémono. Ça c'est l'initiative de la francophonie pour des villes durables qu'Énergie 2050 a cofondée avec l'Institut de la francophonie pour le développement durable, qui est un organe subsidiaire de l'Organisation internationale de la francophonie. Et ça, par exemple, ça vise à créer des stratégies en fait, de développement pour les villes en se basant sur les bonnes pratiques, en se basant sur la mutualisation des bonnes pratiques, sur la communication, pour créer des méthodologies qui soient applicables, même si avec différentes contraintes, chaque ville aura différentes contraintes, mais où on peut appliquer cette méthodologie pour amener les villes vers un développement plus durable que ce qu'elles font actuellement. Donc ça fait partie d'une de nos activités. Dans le cadre de l'initiative, on mène des formations aux professionnels du bâtiment, mais aussi à des master 1, master 2 d'architecture, des ingénieurs en énergie renouvelable, des étudiants en urbanisme sur la transition énergétique, sur l'efficacité énergétique, pour que dans ces professions, ils commencent en fait à intégrer cette contrainte de l'énergie dans l'architecture, dans l'urbanisme, dans la planification des villes. Donc on a des formations qui sont notamment données, puisqu'on part du sud, à l'école d'architecture et d'urbanisme de Lomé au Togo, qui représente, c'est une association inter-état qui représente 14 états d'Afrique de l'Ouest. Et nous, on vient avec des sessions régionales donner en fait des cours sur les thématiques de l'architecture bioclimatique, sur la planification durable, etc. Un autre type d'activité qu'on a, on fait régulièrement des publications sur le domaine du bâtiment. Là, vous avez en fait un runbook en fait sur la finance climatique pour les villes et les bâtiments, parce qu'on sait que un des gros enjeux pour développer des bâtiments plus durables, ça va être ce côté financier, du financement. On a publié également un guide du bâtiment durable en région tropicale, l'état de l'art du bâtiment en Afrique francophone. Donc on fait pas mal de publications qui sont ensuite publiées par le Programme des Nations Unies pour l'environnement ou l'IFDD dont je parlais tout à l'heure, pour justement essayer de partager les bonnes pratiques et faire en sorte que ces bonnes pratiques s'étendent au maximum d'acteurs. On est également membre de plusieurs initiatives, donc je vous ai expliqué tout à l'heure l'initiative de la francophonie pour les plus durables, mais on est également membre de l'initiative bâtiment durable et climat du programme des Nations Unies pour l'environnement et d'autres programmes, et dans ces programmes on essaye de mettre en œuvre des projets qu'on essaye ensuite de dupliquer pour justement avoir des effets, puisque nous on considère que mettre en œuvre un projet par lui-même, aller d'un point A à un point B et ne rien faire derrière avec, c'est pas ça qui répondra aux enjeux auxquels on va faire face aujourd'hui. Aujourd'hui, on a besoin de quelque chose qui soit systémique, qui soit duplicable et pour avoir une vision de masse et des projets qui se mettent sur la masse. Le projet européen aisé, que je ne vais pas m'attarder puisqu'on a un expert qui nous présentera, le coordinateur du projet de l'Université technique de Crète. Donc je vais passer. On a un autre projet européen sur lequel on est également impliqué avec l'Université technique, qui est sur la promotion des contrats de performance énergétique dans les pays d'Europe du Sud. Voilà, essayer de promouvoir ces solutions de financement, ces solutions technologiques auprès des acteurs du secteur tertiaire. On participe également à l'élaboration de plusieurs plans climat énergie territoire, qui sont des nouvelles solutions qui sont mises en œuvre au niveau des communes et territoires pour un développement urbain qui prenne en compte la contrainte climatique et la contrainte énergétique. Donc voilà, je ne vais pas aller plus loin, mais on a encore beaucoup d'actions. On a un stand si vous voulez nous voir ici au Grand Palais. Je vais passer peut-être la parole, puisqu'on parle de NESE, donc je vais faire honneur à Stokas pour nous présenter justement le projet NESE. NESE, c'est Hôtel Presque Zéro Énergie. Il va vous le faire en anglais. Si vous voulez, je peux venir traduire s'il y a besoin. Mais il va parler très lentement. Very slowly. Thank you.
I will speak in English, since I am from the audience. I apologize to my Francophone friends. So, my name is Kajs Tutus. I am a professor at the Technical University of Creta. As you know, Creta is in the city of the center of the East Mediterranean, so exactly a typical tourism industry. It's very typical problems we have to face during some roads. I'm happy because on behalf I represent now not only the University of Creta but also my colleagues from other countries with different roles. I will tell you some things at the end of this presentation, and here you have a good mix, and we are happy now to show you some of our interviews, some of our point of view, some findings from our project. The project is called Near Zero Energy Hotel. It can be a hotel, be a near zero. How near can be a hotel? This is something we can discuss also in this presentation. Tourism is playing a major role in the world economy. As you can see from this presentation, it represents almost 9% of the GDP, 9% of the jobs, 1.3 $3 and also exports and for the world economy, but also for the poor countries. For some countries, especially the less developed countries, the main income is from tourism. But 100% of total greenhouse gas emissions, and the hotels have in some cases the capability to save almost 70%. With the analysis we have done in the hotels, we have seen that this is possible. Why the hotels would like to do this? Which is the motivation? It's the drivers. The hotels would like, first of all, to minimize the operation cost. That's number one. And also they have to have energy security. Energy security is not well known in the continental areas, but for areas remote and off-grid, this is practical. The cost of energy is very high and it's not safety supply all the time. They need to create a new product. The product should be more differentiated or competitive to the others. And also, they would like to keep, this is called sustainability, in the most of the cases for the marketing issues. Or, for instance, in Creta, this is not only the decision of the market, of the hotels, this is also the decision of the visitors. The visitors, the type of the visitors who arrive in Creta, for instance, they would like to be more green. You know, in Creta we have not been fitness. But in parallel, we have to see the European policy. The European policy is very problematic. I mean, now we're almost 5 years before the deadline, and we should take into account that after this period, all new buildings should be near zero. Practically, any new building on 2022 should be near zero. This is be very ambitious, of course. So we have to be realistic at the end of the story. But we're very close. Which were our activities for this project? Our project, first of all, would like to promote and show some very good examples to be replicated. We would like to decide on the near zero energy content target. Even the countries have the national plans with the near zero energy building targets. They have no target, there's no official target for this country for the hotel. So the hotels, maybe it's not clear to all of you, the hotel is not only the building. The hotel is a small community with several activities. Hosting activities, restaurant, but also non-hosting activities. For instance, spa. Or to keep the light, the outdoor light during the evening. It's like small community, small villas. It's not only the building, but so this is a main problem. Trying to explain to the Commission and to the national policies which are exactly targets. So this was one of the purposes of this project. We have identified this type of targets, so we have a plan. Then we have made a ranking of the practice solutions. The people who know, we have done instead of the official, resources, the so-called cost optimal. If you know something about the PPD recast, each country should prepare which are the best solutions in terms of efficiency, in terms of cost, to make it. Then we have done capacity building, training of the hoteliers, of the staff on these purposes. We support the hoteliers to create the real plans and commitments to become near zero energy hotels. And to also, which was the driver, to be for drivers. And then we have created some policy recommendations because we have some, each party has a different influence in the policy making in the countries. So we have, this is the map of the countries which participate in this project, but in parallel, take into account that through NSIS 2050, through Next Tour, through the World Tourism Organization which participates in the project, these examples are totally similar. But what is this? What is near zero hotel? What is zero hotel? What do we mean? In the first point of view is that we discuss about zero energy consumption, but this is not practical. There's nothing to be operation without energy consumption. So we need to minimize demand, but also to use green energies to cover this difference. So this is near zero energy content. How we can do this? One is to take some measures for energy efficiency. This is the most obvious. We need also to use renewable energy sources. And thanks God, especially in the south of Europe, exists a lot of sun. And the third one is to show how the people can change the behavior. This is also very important. And in this card, that we had some idea on this, you can see why the hotels approved to become energy hotels. Because they would like to make some gains as process energy, to improve the driving process, and also to again the story, create the added value as process their responsibility about the climate change. Some highlights from the project. About 86 hotels were candidates to become near zero energy hotels. About 36. 40 of them were being selected in the beginning from all these countries to coincide to make a pre-audit. We would like to create front runners. Our purpose was not to have a lot of hotels, but like to see different typologies, which was important for us. For instance, urban typology, a typology, country typology, or typology, beach typology, sea typology, seaside. Different type of, very different cases. So for different countries. So at the end of the story, we have now 16 hotels, 7 countries, which have committed to become near zero energy hotels. And this is the list of these hotels. You can find a lot of information on our website. It's in different countries. The important issue for everybody is that academically speaking, it's very difficult to find data as concerns the hotel sector. So even the developers of any project can be beneficiary from these findings. This is the list, and of course we increase the list very soon because it seems that has a very big political impact, so awaiting follow-ups. We have created also a ranking tool. This is in cooperation and follow-up of the tool ATS test tool, which has been created before this presentation. So our process uses the previous tool and constructs a new tool to combine with a well-known organization that always has a potential impact globally to make these calculations. And this is an example of this energy audit. What we have done is in each of these hotels, in all these hotels, we have made the energy analysis, take into account the occupancy, month by month, the energy consumption, electricity, natural gas, whatever it is. This is not from Greece, this is from Spain. Incredible, we have no natural gas, this is example, but you will see all the reports, the format is the same. We have seen also the consumption in lighting, heating, ventilation, air conditioning, hot water, all equipment, what we've done. On the other side, you can see the electricity share. You know how difficult it is because the most of the cases have only one category, of course, or two. But we make analysis in all consumption of these hotels, so they know what they have to improve exactly. And also, at the end of the story, we have made suggestions to all of them after this analysis, which solutions are the best and which could be the return of investment, so we can make a ranking to go towards the zero, not at once, so cost will be not very high, we go step by step. Also, we have organized in each country training and capacity building for the personnel, for the staff. This is very important. You are a visitor, the hotel would like to see the staff have a behavior relevant, proper for a green hotel. Also, we have organized, supported by Energy 2050, in Nice. I think a successful Recop event and also a global participation, and we have put a lot of things together to see the critical things for the policy from the point of view. And we'd like also to invite you next January, taking into account the opportunity of the Fitur exhibition in Madrid. We would like to organize there a workshop to discuss the real market. This is the real market we have to discuss, but very close. And it will be in Madrid during this period. Fitur is one of the most important exhibitions in the tourism sector in Europe. And also, this is a card to guide you, all the interesting or your friends, but if you think that very close to this network, to go inside the website, www.president.eu, to become members, so to receive on a permanent basis information useful, essential for this period. And finally, I would like to give you an invitation, which are the partners. First of all, Nextool. Nextool has also helped us with the preparation of the activities during the workshop 2021. WWF Nations Web Tour Organization. We are really grateful because all these activities cannot only a local impact. So we have the possibility to see our activities all over the world and to see the natural impact of all of this. This is profile of my Technical University of Creta Renewable System and Energy Laboratory. REGWA is a European network with major players heating and cooling. This 2050 year. CT is an institute in Torino. This is our Italian partner. SAST is from Sweden. It's an association of major players. This is from the market point of view, so we have a different role in our project. EHAB is from Pozar, the National Institute of Croatia for Energy Efficiency and Energy Saving. CREARA is a major technical company just in Madrid. They are very, very, very good. And APMINI is the energy agency of Krasov in the western part of Romania. Thank you for your patience to hear me all this time. Without
thank you. Sans plus tarder, on va passer à la troisième présentation, qui est un peu plus technique, très bien, in English.
Are you speaking French?
No. In English, from the private sector, so it's a bit a different approach.
Thanks for coming. My name is Peter Hook, and I'm working for two organizations, and last time I met some of you, I was talking about my position from my position at UBEC. UBEC is the European Building Automation and Controls Association, but today I'm here with my German hat on. This German organization I work for is EDMA, which is the German Engineering Federation. I'm especially coming from the Technical Building Systems Forum within EDMA, and the Technical Building Systems Forum is working also with technologies like building automation, but also on technologies like circulation pumps, like HVAC systems, lighting, and so on. So I would like to focus my presentation on the practical issues, how to save energy, and the first slide is where should you focus on. You should focus on the supply side. Or should you focus on the demand side? So the greenest energy, we always say, is the energy that isn't generated at all because we don't need it. And a good example we've heard was nearly zero energy hotels, or zero energy hotels, or in future plus energy hotels, or plus energy buildings in general, because they produce energy, they don't only consume energy. But we have to say the buildings don't consume energy, it's the people working or living in buildings consuming energy. So the greenest energy is the energy that isn't generated, and it isn't generated when you don't need it. So we have to focus on the demand side. And on the demand side we have to look at what energy can be saved. And the sentence also you see on the slide is 1 euro spent and more efficient energy use avoids 2 euro of investment in energy supply. It's also important. So it's important not only to save energy, but also to look at what energy do we really need. And there are enormous saving potentials, and this is just for one type of technology. Some calculations that were made by the SEN committee in the 247, and they calculated several savings that can be done only by using building automation technology. This is not about using extra efficient circulation pumps, extra efficient vents in HVAC systems. It's just from one technology the potential savings. And you see that the savings that can be done by automation technology also in commercial buildings reaches 40%, in office buildings reaches 30%, or 20% in educational buildings, 90% residential buildings. This is just managing a building. This is the technology to manage buildings, and can do that much savings already then. When you then come with efficient technologies like LED, like high efficiency fans, like high efficiency circulation pumps, then it even comes down much more, so you come down to this nearly zero energy building by using all types of technologies. This is the same chart for electrical energy. The first chart was on thermal energy, so there can be savings on electrical energy, but most of the energy used in buildings is thermal energy. The energy that's used for heating and cooling of buildings. What we have to look at when we analyze buildings is we need to have a total facility approach. Meaning we do not look only on several technologies like the chillers, or we do not only look at the circulation pumps, we do not only look at the management system, but we look at all of the building. So a building in future is not only a building consuming energy. In future, a building has three options to deal with energy. One is a building is energy consumption. A building means energy, save energy storage. A building is also energy producing. And all these functions of a building need to be integrated in one building system. And this kind of a building system needs to be looked at in total, not only in parts and pieces of the building. That's one of the major things we have to focus on. This is my favorite chart, and most of you have seen that if you saw my presentations in these or anywhere. I always use this picture because I love it. Energy is the unseen elephant in the room. There's so much you can say, but you have to look at it really room by room. Not only this is a building, but you have to look at it room by room. And this is something I especially show that slide in the UK, where in the UK, but also in other markets, you find you have a heating system in your house, but you only have one controller, and that's a controller in the living room. And there you control the heating of the whole house. And in some rooms you have 27 degrees, in some rooms you have 25 degrees, in the living room maybe you have 24 degrees, but you don't have the control on each and every room. This is important not to only look at the several subsystems of building technical system, but also to look at the building room by room by room. I have some examples that I think are rather interesting, because they show clearly that there are several things you can do with buildings. So this is an example from a logistics center, and I have several examples from all over Europe. This is from Hilti, company Hilti. You might know they have those interesting machines for separate the men from the boys. No, not only the small building machine, but really the big machine that you like to work with at home. And that logistical center, they try to build it especially energy efficient. And what they had to do, because of the ground where the soil where the building is standing on, they have to drive deep tiles into the earth. And they use these piles also to use heat pumps and use terrestrial thermal wells. Now only the Earth needs these piles, and the function of the piles is twofold. It's one to stabilize the ground of the building and to stabilize the soil. But the second thing is to use the thermal energy coming from down in the Earth to make the heating and cooling of your nearby office building. So this is some very intelligent use of technology. You see summer and winter how you can balance the heat demand and the cooling demand of the building over winter and over summer with the heat pump that is in place, where the thermal wells are down in the earth used in the piling that was built. Lots of energy can be saved by using modern technology, and here you find the figures. The payback period of that investment was 8 years. So it's something that really pays back in a reasonable time. Another nice example is from Stuttgart, Cannstatt, German city, and they have municipal archives. And in the municipal archive here we have all the books, thousands of books, millions of books. And you need to stabilize the temperature and the humidity, so you have to have real good technical systems to do that. These systems can be done, can be operated very, very efficient. And what they did, they put heat pumps and they put a big ice storage and heat storage within the building, and where they can stabilize the temperature of the building inside the building, and they can move the temperature inside out. And here you see a nice picture. You see the big ice storage, which is here in the center of the building, underground. And they can store the temperature if the temperature is above. Above the average what they need, they can store the heat there, and if it's below they can get the heat back from the ice storage. So this is a very, very intelligent solution. And I have, of course, your favorite sound is typical in Vienna, so I will skip that because everybody of you have seen this and there is all the figures about that. And another hotel which is very nice, upgraded with Excelsior Telemarketing. So there's tons of things you can do in buildings with building technical systems. So many things you can do, but in the end, what you do, you have to control it. You have to check, am I right? Is it working right? And I have one example how you can do that check, and this is coming also from the building automation side. And within building automation, we have developed something that's called UBEX system. And UBEX system is basically an auditing system where you can analyze very easily. If you're an expert, you have 2 days training from us, then you can analyze quite easy how the building automation system and control system works in the building, and if it's efficient, if the right technology is in place, and if the management of the building can be done the right way. Many systems have already been audited, so up to now we have made 85 audits in different countries. Most of them we have made in Germany, where I come from, and we started in Germany as a pilot project. That's why Germany is so much ahead, but meanwhile we have many buildings also in Switzerland. We started in Spain, we started in the UK to analyze building automation systems. And the good thing about it is that it does not only reflect the actual status of a system that is in place, but it also is helpful to develop key performance indicators of buildings that are then shown up in the building automation system, in the monitoring system. And with these key performance indicators you can do a re-audit. So whenever one of the key performance indicators falls into the red area, then you see immediately something is going wrong within the building. Kind of management mistake, might be a technical failure, might be anything that's going wrong in the building. But you have a direct possibility then to find out what it is, and you have a direct monitoring tool also to analyze the performance of the building over the lifetime. And it's important not to only to look at a building and its actual status at a certain point in time, but also to look at the life cycle cost of the building and how the life cycle cost develops. So this is, and I come to the bus. As I come from Germany, many people keep asking me, energy vendor, this is something that is really also in the news and in other countries as well, and people keep asking me, what does it work, how does it work, what is being done in Germany with regard to energy vendor, and what impact does this have on building, buildings and on the efficiency of buildings. So basically the energy vendor works like this. We want to replace nuclear power plants by renewable energies. That's basically it. I mean the good thing in other countries is that nuclear power plants are actually carbon neutral. So this is taken into the calculations in many, many countries. In Germany we would say, what is the cost linked to nuclear power plants? And I mean, the cost is not only producing the energy, but there's also cost when you have an unlimited time of storage of nuclear waste. And if the time that you have the storage is unlimited, then also the cost is unlimited. But if you have unlimited costs, but a certain amount of money that comes in, it will never pay back in the end, so over the life cycle of the nuclear waste material and so on. From my personal point of view, it makes sense to go that way, to think in that direction. On the other side, we have the CO2, the carbon issue. And then we come with this energy vendor. The newest plan is also to tackle the carbon issue. And this is to shut down also the coal power plants. And this is an issue that's politically maybe feasible, but technically it will not be feasible to do two major shutdowns of technologies within 10 years. So this is something that does not work at the moment and will not work within the next 10 years. So we have to do one thing after another. This is one thing. But what is happening on the building side? On the building side, we have a so-called national action plan for energy efficiency, and now we have an energy efficiency strategy for buildings that came into place end of November. And then we have, unfortunately, the traditional political measures that we always had during the last 15 years are now also in these new plans. So we will have subsidies for energy efficiency investments. We will have several programs for so-called highlight examples, pilot projects, and we will have several restrictions when it comes to building regulations. Building regulations mainly coming then from the EPBD side. You mentioned EPBD, near zero energy buildings coming into place within the next 5 years. And basically the German regulation on buildings is also based on EPBD, and it will come with the next stage in 2016. We will come with another better stage of energy efficiency for new buildings in 2017-2018. Basically, so that's what energy event it means in Germany. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you all for coming. I think we can close the session. Merci à tous d'être venus. En tout cas, je voulais juste un mot de conclusion peut-être pour insister sur le fait qu'on a vu des opportunités d'action. Et aujourd'hui, on a besoin de ça. En fait, les chiffres, on les connaît. On sait qu'on est un peu dans une phase critique au niveau du changement climatique. Et c'est important de voir qu'il y a des opportunités. Les technologies, elles existent. Il y a des projets associatifs, il y a des projets européens. Il y a les secteurs privés qui agissent dessus. Donc voilà, c'était un message un peu d'espoir aussi par rapport à ça. Donc, merci d'être venu. Au revoir.